Good evening, everybody, and welcome back to the Football Podcast, brought to you by your friends here at Monday Madness. I'm Jonathan, your host, and joining me yet again are Neil and Rachel, who are definitely in the same room as me right now.
Hello!
Woohoo!
Seamless. So, we were talking about the 2015-2016 Premier League season, which we confirmed to be absolutely fucking mad. And we were halfway through our club-by-club review, and we stopped at Manchester United because, well, we were tired. But now we're moving on to a new club.
Can I just jump in there and just say, we talked about Man United a lot just towards the end there, and not once did we mention Rooney.
Well, to be fair,
make of that what you will. But
I think what we're making of that is that he was terrible all season.
Yeah. Okay.
He was slowly turning into a potato, which is what nature intended. Let's start off then. Yeah. As much as someone can turn into a potato, I guess. Right. Newcastle United. Relegated this season. 18th place. 37 points. They finished 2 away from their local rivals, Sunderland. Where do we start with Newcastle, gentlemen and lady?
I don't know, man. I mean, like, even, funnily enough, like, When you consider it generally, like, the listless performances, totally inept management right the way through the club, relegation dogfight, absolute hilarious no-shows in the cups. That's actually a standard Newcastle season.
It really is. It's like the more things change, the more they stay the same. It's ridiculous.
But even by their own hilariously low bar.
Yeah.
This season is going to take some fucking beating.
It truly is. I can't understand, and I will still never understand, why Newcastle appointed Steve McLaren.
He was just so clearly not the right man for the job.
He hasn't been the right man for a job since Middlesbrough. And that was Middlesbrough-like. Middlesbrough were just like a wonderful anomaly of football at that time. Like, you're not supposed to treat them seriously.
It's just awful.
No, it's...
Newcastle have just been painful to watch, painful to talk about, painful to think about.
But Arsenal fans, we cannot hate them.
No.
Yes,
You owe it to yourselves to thank Newcastle for this season, regardless of what they did.
Yes.
They,
of course.
They helped immensely.
I was getting to that, despite all of that, they did do us a massive favour, and I'm eternally grateful.
Indeed.
Making it the best birthday ever.
St. Tottenham's Day lives on.
Tottenham's, yeah.
Thank you. I stumbled over it. So too many T's in that thing. You have to change it. But I will say, the one thing you can take out of this is that Rafa Benitez seems to be staying at Newcastle. I don't know why he's staying. He obviously sees something at Newcastle. Or it's like severe Stockholm syndrome. Because I cannot...
To be honest, I think the one thing that Newcastle need to do is anything possible to keep Benitez.
Yeah, absolutely. 100%
agree. Like, whatever it takes. Whatever that guy asks for, he's clearly the right man for the job.
Yeah.
But the thing is that, like, he was given so little time to do it. I'm like, how it took them so long to realise McLaren was so bad.
I really cannot understand this. Like, you first of all, you hire a manager, right? And say, okay, we're going to hire you for an initial 3-year contract. And if you're happy enough, we'll let you stay for another 5 years. So you've given him an 8-year contract right off the bat. Because of course he's going to take the fucking 5-year extension. Because if he gets sacked, he gets 8 years worth of severance. You know, it's a boneheaded decision right from the start. For someone, I think, who quite frankly landed on his feet. Considering the fucking shambles he did at Derby. Like, they had the championship won. And then all the links to Newcastle happened. And the team just went... bang. Out of, like, promotion and playoffs. And if you are Mike Ashley and you were anyway a bit fucking clever, which he's not, by the way, his tick is a fucking sausage, and you look at that and think, oh, it looks like this manager gets poorly motivated when he gets a job or gets any way distracted by outside interference. eh, it's fine. I'll just give him 85 million to spend on fuck all players. It's astounding to see such stupidity. And it's just, it's typical Newcastle. It's typical Newcastle.
In fairness, though, one of the biggest things that happened to them this season was the injury to Krul. And they just had no comeback for that.
Well, this and is... With, yeah.
But well, Darlow was okay.
But you see, Darlow was injured as well.
Oh, shit, yeah.
And so was Stephen Elliott. Or Rob Elliott, sorry. I wouldn't... I mean, you'd imagine that with the money they spent, they would have spent it on a more, like, even squad, if you know what I mean. Like, their squad was immensely top-heavy towards the end of the season.
Exactly, yeah. Mm. Like, they had no kind of depth in, like, defence.
Yeah.
Whenever... I think Jan Mat was injured for a few weeks, and they totally went to pieces. And I actually don't, like... As a player, Jan Mat is actually quite high in my rankings. I thought he did very well.
I think Jan Mat had a great season last season, because he was under Pardew, but just, like, anywhere else, he's been... just off the radar completely.
I think he was okay though. Like, I had him on my fantasy football team, so I'm going on that. But
fair enough.
He got me a couple of points. I can't be mad at him. And then also he scored against Tottenham. So
yeah, okay. That just like remedies everything, isn't it? Just like goal against Spurs. Everything else that was terrible this season, just null and void.
Well, not null and void. It takes the sheen off of it, you know.
Yeah, I guess so. It just baffles me how much money they spent this season and just didn't make any progress. In fact, they regressed, if anything.
It actually kind of reminded me of Queen's Park Rangers a few years ago, where they get in a fancy manager, they get in a fancy manager, Steve McLaren. They get a love player. They just spend a load on shit players and then expect... to get out of the relegation zone, which it doesn't happen, and then they're angry that it happens.
I say we touched upon this when we were talking about Aston Villa, but they just seem disillusioned about where they would be in the table. Like some teams, like we'll get to Watford later on, and we'll talk about West Brom and Bournemouth, and they had a very clear idea of where they were going to be. Newcastle and Villa thought they were above them and got stung as a result because they were completely unprepared for whatever fight they were going to have.
Yeah, exactly. I think the whole thing with Krul set them back because the success of injuries to keepers, you can't have a steady back four. Then there was a couple of injuries and then they just collapsed mentally.
Mm.
Like the players were not good enough to be there in the first place, but they actually just lost any drive to actually try.
Yeah, especially on the McLaren. I've never seen a team just devoid of defending. And the beauty of it is, they've actually fell on their feet in a way by hiring Benitez, who's a very defensive-minded manager. You know, he's all about game management that always starts at defence and works your way up. And you kind of saw that towards the end. But as Neil said, just too little too late. Why do you go 20, 30 games with a manager who has literally ruined your season and then just go, do you know what, we'll give it to Rafa. He's magic. He'll fix everything in 2 months. Yeah. Not even 2 months.
Fact. Yeah, they bought so badly as well. I mean, to be honest with you, when Andros Townsend is your pick of your transfer bunch, he came in January and ran his socks off.
To be fair, I do like Townsend as a player because he's again something that the English side doesn't really have anymore. Just like out and out wide player, is a good dead ball specialist and turns up for some games. Problem is you have to use him right. And it was only because fucking Benitez used him right did he repay that at the end of the season.
But again, to be honest, when you consider the rest of the dross that they brought in, I mean, Thauvin was
desperate.
Shipped off after...
Absolutely
he
desperate.
Was shipped off. I mean, Colaccini and Taylor, I'm like, they were past their sell-by dates before they even started.
Yeah.
Sissoko.
Very disappointed in Sissoko this season. Really am. Really,
you know, I mean, like, fuck it. Like, they blew money on absolute dreck.
Well, let's see now. You have Wijnaldum, who started off strong, and then just...
Yeah.
He's out of there. He wants to go. And
he's too good to be in that team.
Yeah. And even...
I say they'll lose Mitrovic as well, although who would take a risk on someone that genuinely fucking mad?
Well, I think it's fair to say... Alexander Mitrovic is responsible for England not getting the Fair Play Award this season Just like, it's like yellow cards, red cards, crowd disturbance, Alexander
Mitrovic. he's just been fucking crazy. Like, what the fuck goes through that man's head? Like, you think in a game where you've scored a good goal, like, take the Spurs game. He scores a goal, sets up a goal, and he's literally bossing it. Like,
yeah.
I mean, I think who are the centre-backs for Tongan and Alderweireld?
Alderweireld,
yeah. Alderweireld, yeah. Like, they were airtight the entire fucking season. They were considered one of the best centre-back pairings ever. And he literally had them crying like fucking babies.
Well, I think there's more mitigating factors to that with the Spurs collapse, because obviously Spurs are Spurs and Spurs will collapse. That's just in their nature.
But even then, I mean,
you had to capitalize on it, is what you're saying.
When you watch that, when you watch that match back, like every time he moves, they shit themselves.
Yeah,
and then he does that tackle on Kyle Walker, and
that was horrendous. Yeah. I've never seen a tackle so bad.
Sorry, I'll take that back, because I said it earlier on. I can't class that as a tackle, because a tackle is an attempt to win the ball.
assault.
Yeah, it was an assault. Yeah,
what the fuck, like, don't get me wrong, I don't like Kyle Walker, even at the best of times, but I would not wish that on an enemy.
No, like, he got away with that really, really lightly, when you think about it. That was meant to maim him, you know, that was blatantly meant to maim him, and was very lucky as a result.
Just, like I said, whoever, that's his fifth sending off, he's only 22.
Yeah. And if you think about it, like, if you were Anderlecht and like Newcastle just knock up offering 15 million for a lad with his temperament, they just go, right, I'll take that, just leave it under the plant pot, we'll see you tomorrow.
It's like somebody walking up and asking to buy your burning house, you know.
Is your house okay? Yeah, it's got a few flames on it. We'll give you an offer. Yeah, take it. It's all yours now.
It's like you standing in front of your burning house, somebody walks up and goes, oh, here, I'll give you 325,000 for it. What? Yeah, 325. Cool. Do you mind if I check to see whether or not this is real before we make this deal?
I can confirm this is a real building.
Absolutely. Yeah. Or I can confirm it's a real check as well. But fucking hell. It's
just...
If somebody could tame him... Like, just get rid of that psychopathic nature.
Mm.
He would just be some unbelievable.
Well, could Benitez be the man to do that? That is the question. If Mitrovic were to stay in the championship and he gets 50 games this next season, does he calm down?
Because he'll be sent off for 35 of them.
Fair enough.
Do you know who could maybe get him, like, you know, in any way humanized, would be Mick McCarthy. I'd say he could get like his hands on him and just scare the shit out of him.
Sorry, I love the idea of just a hypothetical in my brain. Just like Mitrovic turns up for the first day of training at Newcastle. Championship season's everything's a bit low. Mitrovic gets called into the director of football, who in my head is Joe Kinnear, I don't know why. And just goes, Roy Alexander, it just seems to not work out here, so we're going to give you a loan deal elsewhere. And he goes, oh yeah, great, what have you got in mind? Germany, Italy, back to Belgium maybe? No, we're going to go bring you off to Ipswich. He's like, what's an Ipswich? And then Mick McCarthy kicks down the door going, alright, you big old bastard, come here, you're coming with me. You're going up top with Daryl Murphy.
Perfect scenario for it.
Yeah.
It'd be like getting attacked by a gigantic Easter Island statue.
And careless whispers playing in the background. Every training session.
As Mick McCarthy relentlessly stubs out cigarettes on the back of his head.
It's the only way you'll learn, son. But Jesus, when you look at the players that Newcastle did have, I'm just looking at the squad. Like, there are names here like fucking Wijnaldum, Sissoko, De Jong, Sim De Jong, remember him? Like, he was like signed last season and like had a collapsing lung at the start of the season and never played. And like, again, Jan Mat.
He probably collapsed his lung from exhaling, so from the gas as he was playing for fucking Newcastle.
True, yeah, the smog.
He gasped so hard, one of his lungs turned inside out.
Just like, I'm better inhaling what's in the lung now. And just not going anywhere else. And look at the players that they got in January and never used. Saive, remember him? He was in for Bordeaux. Yeah, exactly. And was never played. I don't think I've actually seen him in the Newcastle squad. And then there was Sadio Dumbia, who was signed and never played. You know, like, if you're that desperate for a solution to this, don't just buy more players and add to the wage bill. That's the wrong thing to do. And just, why do clubs keep doing this?
Because people like to see new names being brought in.
Yeah, but not for when you're, desperate to survive. Like, those names are just going to go back out then, or they're going to stay and cripple you financially. You know,
yeah, but they don't care about that.
No, that's the
your
thing.
Name.
Yeah, that's it.
Your name's responsibility.
Yeah.
That's that short-termism we keep talking about.
Yep. It's pretty rife, isn't it?
Yep.
Well, we better move on from Newcastle before we get really depressed. Hopefully,
Norwich.
Yeah. Yeah, let's move on to Norwich, who are also relegated, 19th place, 34 points. And to be fair, it wasn't a bad season for Norwich, I thought.
They were in my game of the season.
I think I know which game of the season you're talking about.
Ugh.
Mm. We'll get to that at the end, Matron. But, yeah, no, I'm kind of the same way. Norwich were just, mad. They were just, you're playing such great, lovely attacking football. It's a real shame you don't know even how to spell the word defend.
Yeah, to be honest with you, when it comes to the Norwich season, I don't think disappointing quite does it. I think it's more calamitous.
Yeah. It's a championship squad. Let's be fair, they didn't really buy anyone.
Yeah, they didn't really
add
to the squad at all.
No. Which is a good way, good thing in a sense, but not when you're in the Premiership and you're almost required to buy big names right from the bat. Even fucking Bournemouth bought big names and they did well. Watford signed fucking 12 people. And then Norwich just went, yeah, we'll just sign Gavin Naismith, maybe? I don't know. I just want to lie down, really, if that's all right. That was pretty much Norwich, just I'll just have a little nap while the transfer window takes place.
I'm telling you,
it's the case that they're struggling financially because it was never really spoken about whether it was that or not, or whether if they were just we're happy the way we are.
That was kind of the way they were the last time they were promoted. They did get a lot of money. They would have won the playoff last season, after all. So they would have got that extra bit of boost of TV money. So I don't think there was any problem with the financial aspect of it. I think they just didn't really do anything. You know, they just didn't want to sign new players. Or if there wasn't an incentive or players offered to them. I'm genuinely struggling trying to remember a player they signed in the summer, and the only one that comes to mind is Bocani. Because they did most of their business in January, which was actually pretty decent.
Yeah, they actually did get a couple of boys that did kind of sprint to life for one or two matches.
Yeah, Naismith and Klose are the ones I have just noted here.
Yeah, I mean, to be honest with you, if they'd have signed Klose at last summer rather than in January, then maybe things could have turned out differently.
Yeah, absolutely. And it's funny as well, because when you look at the team, there were still very good individual performances. The one, again, another one I'll point out is the two wingers, Brady and Redmond. I think they were fantastic for Norwich's season. Problem was, they were in a team, a very ultimately flawed team. And they couldn't really do anything else. Ah, well, that's probably the best way to summarise Norwich. Just,
yeah, I think I can't even think of any more descriptive words than...
There are no words for Norwich. Just speechless.
Three words. Yeah, 3 out of 10, 3 words. Not good enough.
Boom. And say hello to Burnley next season, lads. Ooh, there's a spoiler for you. Right. Next up is Southampton. 5th place in the table, 63 points. How good were they?
Shillong.
In many respects, they've had an excellent season, even though, funnily enough, like in comparison to last season, they never really got going the same way that they did. Plus, are they in European football?
They are in European football. They are straight into the Europa League because they secured sixth place.
Yeah, they barely in this season they barely dipped the toe into that. So, I think their only real kind of downer this season is the fact that, oh my god, their cup exits were fucking beyond embarrassing.
They just didn't care, really. And this is what pissed me off generally about English teams, like, not the Big Four, but anyone in the Europa League just didn't give a fuck. We'll get to this when we go to West Ham, but just like, Southampton had a great chance to get into the Europa League. It was theirs. And then they just went, fuck it. Just, I'm not interested. I don't care. Don't want to travel. Just, I want to get out of the Europa League so I can focus on the league to qualify for the Europa League. Alright? That's all I want to do. Can I just do that and not travel? Can that work?
Yeah.
Fucking ludicrous. And it's funny as well because it was a relatively slow start for Southampton. They were kind of like wandering a little bit in the table. And they had like a one god-awful month. I think it was December, where they just like won one game in seven or something like that. And
which
then just
was a 4-0 win against Arsenal.
Yes, indeed.
They fucking hammered us.
And it was typical Arsenal, because that's what you guys do.
Yeah. But I'm saying that Southampton have had a quiet season. They kind of just went out, did the job.
Yeah.
Didn't do no flashes, no bangs, apart from maybe that Arsenal match and maybe one or two other matches where they kind of, you know, got the goals in against the other teams. But they kind of just crept up. Like, they were always in and around the top eight. No one really considered them. It was like, oh, Southampton are there, whatever.
The one word I would use is they lingered. They were just kind of there.
Yeah.
There's them and Stoke were just kind of always in the top half of the table. Not really doing anything for the top four or top six, but they were consistent. At least in 2016, they were consistent.
Well, unlike Stoke, I mean, Stoke had a great season up until March. And then, holy shit, the drop-off was unbelievable.
Yeah. We're going up to the Stoke next, but we'll stick with Sam for the moment.
Just saying,
standout players
then,
right? Who's getting sold off next season?
to be honest with you, if they keep Van Dijk, I'll be a fucking amazed. He was
Van Dijk,
brilliant
yes.
this season. Van Dijk, yeah?
Van Dijk, yeah. I think it's Van Dijk, you could be right. Van Dijk.
I would call him Van Dijk, yeah.
Yeah.
Van Dijk. Whatever. He was fucking unbelievable this season.
I genuinely
thought they would really miss Alderweireld.
Yeah.
But got screwed out of keeping him. But my Christ. Van Dijk came in and holy shit.
Yeah.
He was
like, the fact that he cleaned up all the player awards at the club, and there's a reason for that. Also, special mention should go to Tadic and Long.
Mm-hmm.
Back to their vintage. I mean, Long was brilliant.
Like Tadic as well, it was one of those that could have been up for player of the season throughout the Premier League. Had the likes of Mahrez and Ozil like not just stolen the spotlight, because he did phenomenal work for Southampton week in, week out. Again, fantasy football players, he did very well for me. Like, he, scored regularly high points, and that's just on that point of view, the work rate.
He's also badass for the assists as well.
12 assists, I was just about to say, give you a bit of a stat attack. And believe it or not, you've all completely missed Sadio Mane, who was their top goal scorer with 11 goals.
But to be honest with you, Mane had his season last season.
Yes, that's true. But still, 11 goals is a good haul for someone who's supposed to be a left midfielder or left winger.
Pretty much. I mean, don't get me wrong, I'm not saying that he's been brilliant, but he has been. But to be honest with you, like, standout players would have been Van Dijk, Long, and Tadic in that order.
Would you be a bit disappointed in Charlie Austin from this season? Now, he was injured. He was a good bit injured this season, but do you think, because I only recall him scoring the goal against United, which was, again, hilarious.
But to be honest, he hasn't been given enough time. Yeah. I reckon he'll probably fit with the Sebastian
Jay. I forgot he was playing.
Yeah, that's the thing. I forgot he was there.
Yeah.
That's why I had I felt the need to remind you all that Charlie Austin does indeed exist and is at Southampton now.
Stone Cold!
Sorry. Warn me when you're doing that again.
But yeah, Lager had a great season, which I am delighted about.
Utterly delighted for.
We can tell.
But to be honest with you, like, the Southampton, Coleman's really good at kind of trimming the fat, and he's got quite a bit of fat to trim off his current squad. For instance, he is to kind of work out plan Bs for if Pelle, Mane, or Wanyama leave. I think if Pelle leaves, it's not going to be too bad because he had a shit season.
Yeah.
He will need replacing, though.
Well,
but other than that, they do need like wingers.
Well, they are busy at work already, as I understand that they are looking at Anderlecht's Dennis Pryett, which is a defensive midfielder. So they're already looking to get him in early enough.
To be honest with you, they'd be brilliant signing Townsend.
Oh, interesting.
Oh.
Right. We'll keep that in mind for later on, yeah.
It's not as if he wouldn't go.
Hmm. Yeah, no, I can now that you've pitched it to me, I can see it happening. But Oxlade-Chamberlain as well, for that matter. Right midfield, out and out right midfielder. Back to where he was.
Back to his old.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Could be a good place for him, even on a loan deal.
Yeah.
It could be a good shout.
Yeah. So again, a promising season for Southampton. Just quietly got around their work, made stars of players again. Problem is, though, they are a selling club. They will probably let go of one or two players. If I had to pick ones out, I'd say Forster could possibly get picked up by somebody. If Karius doesn't work out, I'd say Liverpool might go for him. I doubt it, though, because he kind of teetered off towards the end. But definitely Sadio Mane is going somewhere. I can see it happening. It's either going to be...
Is Wanyama spoiling for something as well?
Wanyama was doing that for Spurs last season, and then just, like, Southampton said, fuck off. They just basically said, no.
Yeah.
They literally laughed it off like it was nothing. And it was kind of funny as a result. It was like, you want to go to Spurs? No. We already had a player go to Spurs. You can fuck back off into training. And he kind of did. So it was kind of worthwhile. But, I don't see Long moving anywhere, but you never know with the league. It's crazy. Hey, let's move on then. We were talking about them just a few minutes ago, but Stoke City. They finished ninth for the third year in a row. 51 points this time. And more the same, I guess, from Stoke. Just getting away from the Pulis football into the more sexy, interesting, sparky football, where they just sign nothing but Madrid and Barcelona alumni. But whatever works for them, I guess.
Yeah. Well, you have to say they're consistent.
Yeah, definitely consistent. It's a fucking... I thought Arsenal were the groundhog club of the league, but definitely Stoke have a good show for
it. Well, they've definitely ticked every box. I mean, they had a top 10 finish, and they had a cup fight. They had a semi-final.
Yeah, Carl League won the League Cup semi-final against themselves.
So it's going to be, you know, a season of what ifs. I think next season's going to be the telling one for them. I think if they don't push on next season, questions are going to start getting asked.
Yeah, I maybe.
No, I reckon like he's had what, three seasons now?
Yeah,
he's had three seasons now. You know, again, he needs to shit or get off the pot.
Yeah. Fair enough. Like, it has to be some sort of progress.
It's not as if he doesn't have the players. He's got fucking great players. I mean, you want standout players. You've got Arnautovic and also Butland.
Yeah, I had them, would you believe? I think you were right reading my notes, Neil, because I just had exactly that, saying the emergence of both of those players. Yeah, I was about to say. Because, like, fucking hell, Butland was a revelation this season. He really was.
Fucking hell, he's been fucking brilliant.
Yeah. It's such a pity as well he got injured, because he was fucking a shoe-in for England number two at the Euros.
He was fucking excellent, absolutely.
And he's going to be a top player for the next season. Hopefully, again, his form doesn't drop too much when he comes back, because he was so solid for Stoke. And, again, a good reason for their success.
Oh yeah, very very much so. And again, with
Arnautovic, they have got a whole thing of having very good goalkeepers. They've never not had. Well, okay, David James a few years ago, but then they had Begovic and.
Fucking hell, that's a name from years past.
Calamity James.
Yeah.
But then Begovic and now Butland, and I think you've just got beasts in defence that they'll just hack you down, tough to get through. Midfield is actually starting to play football a bit last few years.
Yeah, lads, let's talk about this. Like, this one really knocked us for six. Jerdan Shaqiri, Bayern Munich, Inter Milan, Stoke. How the fuck does that happen?
Well, to be honest with you, they kind of really were throwing out money on the fucking transfer market. Remember that gimp that they signed for 20 million quid in Beulah?
Yes, the Porto lad. Yeah, that was in January.
Yeah. What the fuck? Where has he gone?
I think he scored in the last game, I understand.
Yeah, that's 20 million down the fucking drain as far as they're concerned. Mm. So that's another kind of what if. And again, another question that'll start to be asked. But to be honest with you, they're crying out for a natural goal scorer, which is why they signed him.
Yeah. You know? Well, he's meant to be a deep laying midfielder. I get the feeling he's meant to replace Whelan. But Whelan is so rock solid for Stoke, when you think about it. Our Glenn Whelan. In the same way like Jonathan Walters always gets a nod ahead of fellas like Hosselu and Afellay and Diouf and Bojan. These were big names. Walters gets ahead.
I was watching a thing, a sports recap of the season there. It was actually before the season ended, but it was kind of coming up to the last few games or whatever. And it was just showing how Stoke is actually built around Glenn Whelan, and it's just such an alien concept to have someone so bad at football.
Well, that's the thing. It's this thing that happens in football where you have a position that nobody likes. The ball winning defensive midfielder is the most blind thing. It's the pantomime villain of football. His job is not to attack. It's not to do anything. It's to fuck up everyone else's day. I'm honestly surprised that Pulis didn't sign him for West Brom, because that is the literal West Brom footballer. I don't care where you are from, your leg, my boot, right now. We were always like that with Lucas Leiva. He's the same type of player. And this is the fact, Lucas is in the team again. We keep winning. Sweet. It must be because of our attacking players. Nope. It's because of Lucas Leiva. And it's genuinely the only reason. I'm sticking to that. But I will say one thing about Stoke is I'm surprised now at how big their squad is. They're going to have to release a lot of players next season. I will just name some players that are currently employed by Stoke. Shay Given, obviously, he's 55 now or something, I don't know. Phil Bardsley is still there.
Wow.
Mark Wilson is still there. Steve Sidwell is still there. Charlie Adam, Stephen Ireland, I say with giant quotation marks because fuck you, and of course Peter Crouch is still there.
Jesus Christ.
And I didn't realise he was still there. I actually thought he'd retired.
I know, right? These are lads that are, will need to go somewhere else, because if we're going with the Stoke alone a revolution.
Glue factory.
No, lad, let's just face it, Crouch is going to just be there to do dances. That's all he's doing. He's doing the robot, and he's going to do something else, and that's it. He's there to be a fucking sideshow.
And also, I don't think you want to rely on the kind of glue that's made from Charlie Adam.
It's going to be very fatty glue, isn't it? It's going to really... when you use that glue, it's going to congeal, and it's probably going to turn into batter at some stage.
Yeah, it's going
to
look like something...
I like to think that Charlie Adam is, Wayne Rooney's final form.
He's the evolved form of Wayne Rooney.
Yeah.
Evolved.
It's just instead of giving him a Firestone or a Waterstone, you give Rooney a battered sausage. and you just like feed it to him, and he just Charlie at him straight away.
No, you have to give it to him the way he likes it, like one in each ear.
Oh, is that how he eats? Okay. Oh yeah, but, and you know who else is still at Stoke? Peter Odin Wingy.
Oh, for fuck's sake.
Even like the website I'm looking at forgot Peter Odin Wingy was at Stoke. I couldn't find him.
Jesus Christ.
Wow, man. Wow. So there you go. That's Stoke, really. It looks like it's just two teams at once. It's like it's before and after, you know. And it's eventually, it has to be time for them to make a decision. Which team do they want?
The sack the before.
Yeah. That's their cup team is the thing. But still, it's a promising start. You know, they've got world-class talent in midfield. All they need now is, yeah. I say they just need someone up front to lead them to it.
They need a double-digit score. Yeah. Badly.
Yeah, I don't think Juve and Bojan aren't cutting it. Okay, yeah. Let's move on then. We have, up next, the team lying in 17th place with 39 points. Somehow survived relegation, Sunderland. Big Sam strikes again.
I was about to say that. I was like, it's no surprise how they stayed up. You want to know why they stayed up? Three fucking words. Big Sam Allardyce.
Boom. Just.
That baby's got dank.
Oh, man. It's just like, he always strikes. Do you think like he's like Batman and he has his own kind of like lantern where he's just, someone just pointed in the sky as it's a picture of like a fucking burger or something? Or a pie. A pie, actually. It's going to be a pie. And it's
just
like...
No, sorry. I just can't get past that like meme image of him celebrating. Somebody's... It's like a big goal celebration and he's clearly put his fist up and he's like, yeah, he's got this big yeah face on him, and somebody has photoshopped in Miley Cyrus then.
Yes,
over.
Oh, I remember that.
Like,
yeah,
it looks like he's plastering her from behind on the flag on the pitch.
I remember that picture.
But the thing is that even though it's such a poor Photoshop, it works so perfectly well that your mind kind of erases all the rough edges that shouldn't be there.
Yeah, I know. It's amazing. But yeah.
But with Sunderland staying up, I'm devastated because just the whole debacle and horrendous use of Adam Jansen.
We'll get to him. We will get to
they
him, believe
They don't
deserve
me. To be a football team.
Oh, my no. God, yeah. They fucked up. And I think they'll say themselves they fucked up. But, it's a... For everything that happened, like, off the pitch, like, Sunderland are just going to go, yay, we did it. Okay, let's go hide now before people get angry at us.
Yeah.
You know, like, yeah, if anything, Big Sam has made it all kind of go away for, like, a few seconds. And then people go back to... You hired a paedophile. Okay, no, hang on. I object to this. Especially since the cunt scored against us as well, denying us points. The fucking fiddler. Sorry, I'm still bitter. But yeah, they really fucked up with that one. I think everyone knows they did. There's been resignations. I think everyone would have been happy if they were relegated. But once again... Yeah. The more you want them to go away, Big Sam just keeps them back.
Like, I like Big Sam, but, just the whole ethics of it all was just beyond my, beyond my compassion, I suppose. But in terms of football, they were absolutely horrendous, as well as that, you know, anyone who has John O'Shea as their captain just shouldn't be allowed to play football.
Well, to be clear,
we go back to the start. We can go back to the start of this kind of review, and we're saying, "Oh, Sunderland, three words, why they stayed up."
If you
don't want to go with Big Sam Allardyce, you can go with three others, which is Kone, Kasri, and Kirchhoff.
Defoe as well.
Defoe as well, but those three were brought in.
I will say it was a super January from Sunderland. They saved their season from that. Absolutely.
You know, getting Cabell to actually start fucking playing football. And Vito Manone not doing what he normally does, which is flappy, 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 flap.
I love as well, like, you see all the business that, like, Sunderland did in January. They signed in, like, really good players, like Kaz.
They also got rid of a lot of fucking dress. Mm-hmm. I mean, like, they got rid of so much shit, like.
Well, they didn't quite get rid of Stephen Fletcher. They just kind of let him have a French holiday.
Well, you can never really get through really, truly rid of Stephen Fletcher. I think you can get a load of like vanish oxy action and rub it into his eyes before he'll go away.
A couple of doses of antibiotics.
Yeah, and let's check back in 2 months and hopefully the infection is gone. If not, it's another weekend in Marseille for you. Hey.
Actually, that's how you got it the first time.
Yeah, exactly. And now Marseille are stuck with them, the poor bastards.
But to be honest, like, they've a few really bad players there. Like, they got Lenz is shit.
Oh, he's completely unfocused.
Rodwell, I mean, like, Christ.
Well, let's look at the team now. Look, there are names here.
No words.
Yeah, there are names that should not belong.
I can't be.
Do you know that Steve Harper is employed by Sunderland?
I actually did.
Yes. Yeah. Let's see, we have Billy Jones, who's actually in the first team, so that's fine. Sebastian Coates, who you paid money for him, that's adorable. Emmanuel Leboué, who was employed for
a week
and then gone again because of betting thingies. John O'Shea, Wes Brown is still there, I think. Yes, he is. And my boy DeAndre Yedlin is there, but of course he's on loan from Spurs. Sorry, I'm still gonna call him my boy because of his name. And Adam Matthews is somebody. I don't know who he is. I don't know who Adam Matthews is. I think he came from Celtic. That's all I know about him. And he's employed by
Sunderland. More than what I know about
him. Yeah. And fucking Lee... lads. Lee Catamol is here. Still. The fucking, like, shorts up to his nipples. I think he gets shorter every time he plays. I swear to God. I think he does. I think he, like, removes vertebrae off his back for some sort of, like, tactical advantage. Or maybe because he can bite people's balls off or something. I don't know, okay? He's a weird person. Who else? Jordi Gomez is there. And Jaccarini is still employed. Ola Toivonen.
Oh my god, Jaccarini.
Yeah, and Will Buckley, who was fucking Gus Poyet's best mate from Brighton. He's there. Fucking, there's so much dreck in this team. Danny fucking Graham is still there. And they can't get rid of him. You know... And, okay, granted, one good player turned out for Sunderland even throughout all that, and that was Watmore. I actually quite like him.
I have no opinion of him because I can't even think of what he looks like.
He's ginger. That's all you need to know. He's ginger and he has an economics degree. I know that from seeing one feature on him on Sky Sports. That was all they knew about
fucking
him.
Hell.
Yeah. But he's a tight enough player, actually. He might turn out good next season. You never know.
Oh, yeah, I know him.
Because, I mean, obviously... Yeah, you know him. Because obviously Fabio Barini is going off to Celtic to hook up with Brendan Rodgers again. This is just guaranteed. So, Defoe will need a friend up front. And that friend is not Stephen Fletcher. He'll need Watmore. Oh, there you go. That's my comprehensive review of Sunderland. And completely varnishing over the fact that Adam Johnson was there. Anyway, let's move on to Swansea. 12th place in the league. Points 47. This was surprisingly good for Swansea, considering how bad they were at the start.
Yeah, they looked like they were had nailed on for relegation.
Yeah.
Like after the first few matches.
They were in fierce trouble. They were in very fierce trouble. And they just somehow bounced back from it.
And it wasn't any of the big names that brought them back. It was the likes of IU, who was kind of a nobody at the start of the season.
But he started off decent and then just disappeared. Like,
yeah.
I think he scored in the first few games and then was gone then. Still, 12 goals is not bad. Not bad at all.
Yeah.
But I think the standout player for me was Sigurdsson. Out of that Swansea team, Sigurdsson just, like, when Wiedlin came in, he just went to another level. Like, every set piece was perfect. Every free kick and penalty was spot on. And I think he scored about 10, 11 goals, I think. Could be wrong about that.
But yeah, he's been brilliant. And I think it's actually no coincidence that his form massively improved when Shelby moved to Newcastle.
Oh, absolutely, yeah. Yeah, you can see Shelby was just kind of like ruining his flow in a way. Because Sigurdsson just likes to, not necessarily, he's a very static player, but he's a dead ball specialist. Shelby, bless his heart, thinks he's a dead ball specialist, but he's not. he's absolutely not. So, yeah, you can definitely tell there was a very quantifiable improvement. Overall, lads, would you say the sacking of Gary Monk was harsh?
It's hard to know because they were playing so badly, but whether it was a case of, oh, give another match or two, they would have kicked on themselves, I don't know.
Mm.
I don't think so, really, because, I mean, Gomez just had an awful season.
Do you know who else got an awful season? Adair. The lad that got in from Braga. Oh, my God. He's in the Portuguese national team.
Yeah, the other guy they got in as well as him at Tabanu.
Yeah, oh, he was dreadful. Didn't even play. You
know, yeah, they should be looking for other clubs, man.
Yeah.
Like, So Gwydlin's got a lot to do.
Yeah.
I mean,
well, like I said, I think that main thing now is going to try and keep IU anyway. Because getting him on
he's their only real, like, big transfer target risk.
I'd say
Sigurdsson could be poached as well. You never know, like, some teams need a set piece guy.
Yeah, he's too old for anyone to try and grab.
You never know. Some teams are silly with their money, you know. They're going to look at him.
Well, like don't get me wrong. Like, whenever we say, oh, Sigurdsson's a little too old, we're assuming, like, sense and logic, which don't always apply.
I mean, if I were running a football team,
I'd
resign because that's silly.
So I don't want to be a fan of any team that would have me as a board member.
In fact, I immediately resign right now and I'm just going to go into cricket. It's just easier for everyone. But I think the main thing for Swansea is just to hire a fucking decent striker. Like, holy shit. We were saying about like two or three teams in the league already, but how hard is it to find a striker that knows how to score and you're not relying on Ayew, who is meant to be a midfielder, and Sigurdsson, who's meant to be a midfielder, you know.
They'll need to boost that midfield now that you've mentioned it. They will need that midfield. Those need a kick.
Yeah, I would say they need somebody in, because they didn't actually replace Shelby at all. They just kind of let it happen, which was really curious. But whatever, it worked for them.
When that happened, I just assumed one of the young lads was going to come up and do the job, but it really was just like, oh, who else can we chuck in here? It was like, it was a really static move. Like, nothing came of it at all, which I thought was quite unusual.
It was, wasn't it? Because you usually see, like, okay, we're selling off this player, one of our English lads. There's usually a plan B, but they just got your man fucking Fair from QPR on loan. And that's not doing anything, really. That was like a fucking deadline day deal. And I get the feeling Swansea did it so that the agent would fuck off. I was just like, we got him. All right, fine. We'll sign him for the season. Will you please leave us alone? I get the feeling it was something like that, because it was just such a like foolhardy transfer. But although they are getting taken over now, so it's, I guess it could be some movement money wise for Swansea, because they were starting to get a little bit in the quandary. Like, they weren't really going anywhere. There's no progress for Swansea, especially after the last few seasons. So they'll have to definitely spend this season to keep up with the rest of the pack.
I'm glad Fabianski has been doing well though with them.
Fabianski has been fine, and it's funny saying that. Ever since he's been at Swansea, he's been fine. Because you know yourself, he's been horrifically inconsistent for a while, and now he's just kind of relaxed and settled down a bit. So this is good. It's important for him for that.
It's nice to see.
Yes, indeed. So let's press along then. This one might be interesting. Tottenham Hotspur, third. Gee whiz, I wonder why. Somehow I felt that was going to happen. I don't know why. Anyway, Spurs, they finish third place in the league. 70 points. Where shall we... I'm going to take the lead on this one. I'm going to mention the positives. I'm going to call them a youthful and energetic squad with the potential to be league winners. I'm saying that. They secured the long-term future of Mauricio Pochettino, which is very important, and the standout performances by Harry Kane and Dele Alli. Now, the negatives will be that they will be tempted to sell stars for profit, which would be Lloris and Kane, obviously. They very much lost confidence when the title race was over. They just completely dropped, particularly at the Chelsea game. They just gone. Heads were down, just didn't bother. And potentially, the style that they have now will be hindered by playing on Wednesday nights. So, I have said my piece. I have said at least some positives for Spurs. I now give the floor to the two Arsenal fans that are not in the room right now. How was Spurs this season?
Do you know what? I was genuinely worried.
Oh, I was terrified.
That is as much praise as I am willing to give.
I was mildly concerned.
Yeah. No, to be honest, like, what Pochettino has done at Spurs is nothing short of a fucking wonder.
Mm. Yeah.
They now attack and defend as a cohesive unit. They're really tough to break down. They all seem to have bought. They've all bought into the singular philosophy that he's brought in.
Yeah.
The thing is that there's no depth to the squad.
Yeah, that was an interesting thing. But they have a lot of players under contract and a lot of like young fellas that are in the system. And they were either going to be like either loaned out or used in like the Europa League, which some of them were.
No, see,
like,
they have
a smaller scale Chelsea loan firm.
Yeah, in a way. And they're all English lads as well, which is even weirder. Like they have just a stranglehold on those kind of players.
You know, so, I mean, the thing is, like, all the world, or like the way they stole him away from Southampton was a masterstroke. Whatever back room agent made that happen deserves a fucking raise, because he's a great reader of the game. Eric Dier, Ali, Dembele, they're all brilliant.
I think Dier in particular now stood out for me as a really important player for Spurs, because Bentaleb was in that position and was like masterful. He was masterful under Sherwood, but then Pochettino asked too much of him and didn't like it.
Yeah.
So, and then Dier just stood in straight away.
And then, like, he's actually turned Lamella into a player that looks actually halfway fucking decent.
Yeah,
so.
As well. It's
we laughed at Lamella constantly.
Oh my god.
Like, a couple of seasons. Mm. And now it's like, oh, Lamella who? Oh, the fuck, he scored again.
Yeah.
You know, it's just kind of been like, god, he actually is a player and not just a pile of cash thrown into a jersey.
Yeah. And let's not forget, lads, Christian Eriksen.
Eriksen's always terrified me, like, for them. Like, to be honest with you, I'm like, you go back a season or two, and people are like, oh, what Spurs players would you take? And I went, well, if we couldn't have Lloris, I'd always have taken Eriksen.
Oh, absolutely, yeah. And the crazy thing is, Eriksen is like 24. There's still a good 10 years ahead of him, and that's the scariest part. This is not his final form.
No, and Kane's just going to get better as well, which is...
Yeah, and Ali and Dier, and this is just a team that's going to improve. So,
But that's what I mean. Like, we've just named their starting 11.
Mm.
Go behind that, and you've not got a lot there. Who were their replacements?
Just on that there, like, Dier and Lamella picked up 21 yellow cards between them and not a single red.
Yeah.
Which shows that, like, they can, like, they are playing half-decent football, like, but they're also doing the grind as well, which is kind of scary when you think of it, because that's something maybe that, like, those two players together got more yellow cards than our entire back four.
Yeah. The point is that they're getting stuck in, and you wouldn't expect that from Lamella, who always seemed to be a bit of a princess, at least under Villas-Boas. Like, he wouldn't go in for a tackle, he didn't really want to get involved with like actual scraps on the midfield. He'd always drift away, but now Pochettino has him in that system going, it doesn't matter if you get a booking, commit the foul, do it, because you're doing it for the rest of the team.
Yeah,
and
exactly.
That must have took so long to get that drilled into him, because he doesn't seem that like that kind of player. And even when you told me that stat, I thought, that must be more for Dier than Lamella. You know, because it's positionally based as well.
But what I'm saying is that, like, behind that that very good first 11.
Yeah.
They've not got a lot, right? They've got what? Carroll, Mason, Chadley, who?
Yeah, who?
Exactly. So I'm like, how far?
Got injured a few weeks back. There was panic of who's going to score our goals, and because they actually don't have anyone else, they would rely on their midfield.
Mm.
So when they don't have that forward outlet, then the midfield are outnumbered. They are outwitted really by the opposition. Like the thing was this season, if you took Kane out of the game, Tottenham were fucked.
Yeah. And that became an issue for them big time, all right. Especially, again, I think it was more towards the end of the season when they had eyes towards like the Euros, and Kane's form just dropped big time. Like you could almost see there was like the trashing of Stoke, the beating of United really comprehensively, and then Pulis, Chelsea, Southampton, Newcastle. Just like, yep, league's gone. Fuck it, Euros. Don't get injured. that's the mandate now.
And also as well, like they're very heavily reliant on Dele Alli as well.
Well, you see, he became very prominent. I don't think it was the plan to become dependent on him. It was like Rashford for United. He just kind of emerged quicker than expected.
Well, see, that's just the thing as well. I think I remember reading somewhere like their win percentage drops like by about 30% when they don't have Dele Alli.
Yeah, it's just having that dynamo in the midfield. And
to replace that. They've nobody. They've got a great player in Kane. They've got a great player in Dele Alli, Dembele as well, and Lamella. But they've got nobody to replace them.
Yeah.
Oh, well, it's not that they've got nobody. The players they have to replace them are fucking leagues behind the players they're to replace.
That's the thing when you have a box-to-box midfielder like that. When he's playing every day, he's in a flow. He keeps moving and moving. And so long as you're keeping that like consistent midfield, that box-to-box midfielder, he's like a dynamo. He keeps moving and moving and moving. He's getting fitter each time. When you try and replace that, though, it's hard to replace. It's hard to change that. You know.
And like when we go back to the start, just like a little review of them. Mm. What the fuck happened to Bentaleb?
Yeah, I was really surprised at how he dropped out. I think personally, he doesn't like the way how much running is involved with the Pochettino side. You know.
Yeah.
Because when you face it, they do cover more mileage than most teams. I think it was like ourselves, Bournemouth and Spurs are the three like fittest teams, as it were. But Bentaleb just doesn't seem that kind of player. He seems to be very static and just like commits fouls and breaks a play. Sure, would love them for that because it was a position that nobody was doing back then. But now you have Eric Dier who can do both running and breaking a play. And that is going to be where the Spurs team will prevail next season, I think. Like it's like how Leicester prevailed this season. Like you had Conte to Mahrez to Vardy. Spurs will do the same thing. They'll go Dier to Ali to Kane. And they'll think even better profit-wise because they're all English. And you can buy them all for a three, buy one, get two free or some shit like that. Because Spurs will always keep thinking of it like that.
But last day of the season, and they bottled it.
They did, and I think it's very hard. I think it's very hard on them as well because they did play so well over the season. They did, though. Come on, like they deserve to get. I think they deserve to get runners up purely by how good they were throughout the season. They were very consistent.
We considered like you know everyone that we were talking to at the stadium was like we've had such a shit season.
Yeah.
And, Tottenham have had such an amazing season and yet we still finish above them. It's just, the world's order has been corrected.
There is no need to be upset.
Yes. I'll fully agree with you that they deserve to get second. But this is football, pal. You don't always go first to deserve.
Well, like you said, they're gonna be back next year and you're gonna have the right firepower to go with them. Because all they need to as you said, Neil, they're just gonna start getting players in for the depth.
Yeah.
And if they can get, imagine now, if they can get a player that plays up front with Kane that scores the same number of goals. Like they've had names like Batshuayi and Lacazette and other players like that that are being linked with them and they are willing to spend money. So it's going to be an interesting year for you guys trying to put up or shut up with Spurs.
Yeah.
So there we go. Right, we're on the home stretch then for this club-by-club review. We're going to move on to Watford now, one of the promoted teams, last promoted team of this group, and they finished 13th, highest of them all, with 45 points. Can only be a good season for Watford, surely.
Well, not really, because they lost the fucking manager who got them there.
Yes, but let's face, this is Watford, by the way, who let go of the manager that got them promoted as well. So I think it's as par for the course for them.
That's not really a good par.
Sorry, what was that, Rachel?
Sorry.
I'm just saying that they played really, really good. Like the likes of Didi, Igaloo were...
Igalo, not Igloo.
Yeah, it's Igloo.
No, we're going with Igloo.
Change approved.
Change approved.
Yeah. Oh, man.
They played really well. Like, they were unstoppable form. And, like, you can't really complain with being the highest placed newly promoted team.
Yeah, absolutely. And consider as well, they brought in a fuckload of players. Like from all the other teams that like the family owns, it's they kind of had to perform, because if they didn't, they were a little bit fucked. But that's a huge squad they have. Like, you need to start culling that big time.
Yeah, I don't know what changes can be made. Like, they have to trim a lot of the deadwood, which there is so much.
Yes.
But who? Like, they're not going to get a whole lot of cash for that. And who can they buy with what cash they have?
Yeah, this is going to be the thing. Like, it's because of all the inter-club relationships, they can just pick and choose who they want. They can get anyone from Udinese or pick anyone from Granada. You know, it's a little bit cheating, but it's just the way the clubs are run. It works both ways, though. I mean, if Udinese suddenly say, yes, we want Odion Ighalo, I said, fuck, okay, you can take him, give us the money. And vice versa.
Yeah.
It's a bit bullshit.
They definitely need to replace. They definitely need to look at their fullbacks.
Yes.
I mean, they're losing Ake because he's gone back to Chelsea.
Who's super, by the way, this season. We didn't even mention.
He's fucking brilliant.
Yeah, he's a super defender. Pity Chelsea don't fucking use him.
Yeah, but to be honest with you, that's just Chelsea.
That's Chelsea. Yeah. Chelsea.
To be honest with you, like, they've had a lot of success with it, especially with Ighalo, Gomez, Deeney, and Watson.
I was surprised that Watson is still in the first team. Because, like, when you think of Watford like that, yeah. But, like, they signed so many, like, foreign players. I think Neil used the term, they were the United Colours of Benetton over the year.
Oh, fucking hell.
Yeah. They have so many nationalities. And then here's, like, Ben Watson, FA Cup hero Ben Watson, that gets a nod ahead of, like, lads like Berami and Amrabat and Anya. You know, it's so weird seeing that. But it's just picking the right team, picking the best team. And they've done it.
Picking the team that'll do the job.
Yeah.
Surprisingly, Ben Watson has been doing it and been doing it really well.
Yeah. I mean, it is a bit harsh on Flores to lose his job. But do you think... And here maybe be being a bit of a conspiracy theorist. Do you think he was dismissed because Walter Massari made himself available? Like, on paper, would you have gone for Flores over Massari or vice versa?
I don't know. I think if someone's doing the job that Flores is doing, I don't see how you can justify getting rid of him.
And Neil, what do you think?
Yeah.
Same as well. You'd stick with Flores, yeah.
To be honest with you, I'm like Slaven Bilic came out quite harshly when Watford announced that they were getting rid of him.
Yeah.
He slammed the move as sick.
Yeah.
Now I probably wouldn't go that far, but it's cold.
Mm.
You know, what worries me about it was the lack of emotion about the whole thing, which was fun. And it seems really, because Watford seemed to be quite a proactive club, so I reckon that this isn't a snap decision. That they'd a long time ago, they'd made the decision that he was going, unless he, say, won a cup.
Yeah, maybe that's what they were waiting on, was to see, like, would he, like, get to the FA Cup? But even then, do you think they would have kept him even if he got to the final? If it was United versus Watford, like, yesterday, and it was Watford that... were runners up, he probably would have been locked gone anyway.
Yeah, maybe, you know.
If they focused on that, then our league form would have been relegated. I think if they were to focus on something like external to the league, they would have been relegated. So
that is a very good point. Yeah, like it was their job. Like you look at their December form, they won 4 games out of 5 in December or something along those lines. That is what kept them up, and then it was the second half of the season that just ruined them. So.
Yeah.
Maybe they're looking at it that way. It's like just keeping the managers on their toes by saying, you lose 6 in a row, you're out. Which is so bullshit, because there's so many mitigating factors to that. It could be anything, you know. It is a bit harsh on Flores, but you never know. We might see him back. He might be going off to a better job. Like, you know, Watford might be...
I think he was a very good manager.
Yes.
I would like to see him back.
Yeah. And he wore a lovely card.
I would love to see him back, because the way he dressed and the way, like, in every single photograph, he always looked like he was about to drop the most banging grime album of the year.
Are you ready for Kike?
Yeah, you know, like, he really did look like he was about to do that. But to be honest with you, like, I don't know. With Watford's next season will be a whole reap what you sow kind of.
Yeah, definitely, definitely.
Thing. It's either going to go one of two ways. One, this is going to work out for them, and they're probably going to maybe finish in around 10th, you know.
Possibly
and with a better,
top 10, yeah.
With a better cup run, maybe a semi-final, maybe a final, maybe if they get far in the Wolves Cup.
Yes.
Or... it's going to go fucking disastrously and they're probably going to get relegated.
Well, precedents would say, if we're going by lads like Fulham and QPR, it's going to be the latter, isn't it?
Yeah. That would be spectacular, like Villa-esque capitulation.
That's a new low. Wow. It's like, yep, they're just the Pizzo family are just going to leave and lunatics are going to run the asylum.
Pretty much.
Okay. Well, we are nearly finished here. We just have two more teams to talk about. West Bromwich Albion, position 14th, points 43. We okay with that?
Yeah, they were just like typical Poulos team of, you know, grinding out results.
I think one word for it would be joyless.
Yeah, I think we can just like... there's nothing else to say. There's nothing else to say about this. They survived. They're comfortably in the Premiership. That's it.
Yeah, when it comes to like judging their league expectations, they can say, we met all of our expectations. But then the counter to that would be, well, your expectations were only met because they were so fucking low.
It's just like, well, we didn't die. Was it? That's not saying anything.
Poulos didn't have to headbutt someone while naked in a bed.
And by the way, I followed up that story. Do you know who that player was that he headbutted? James Beattie. It's a day ago.
Wow.
I actually looked it up to see because I was baffled by who the player was. Oh, man. There you go.
To be honest with you, like, when it comes to, like, there's always... massive pros and cons to their season.
Yeah.
One massive pro was they managed to get rid of Lescott and got in Johnny Evans.
That was a great signing, I must say. Yeah.
And
let's not forget, lads, they signed Salomon Rondon as well.
Exactly.
That was another what the fuck signing.
Craig Dawson's been looking good as well.
Yeah, it's a typical Poulos thing where the fucking defenders score more goals than the strikers.
Yeah,
it's just
like Gareth McCauley is a regular.
I know.
Assists and goal merchant.
Oh, he's the assist master.
It's just like, you look at, this is how, I think, I'm pretty sure, I'm going to put myself on a limb here and say that Tony Poulos is the devil. Because you cannot secure Premier League survival when you have a team that includes people like Boaz Myhill, Jonas Olsen, Gareth McCauley, Craig Dawson, Claudio fucking Jacob, I don't even know he's still alive, James McLean, who's doing fine, right? Stefan Sessegnon, Victor Anichibi, Ricky fucking Lambert, And Saido Berahino.
Dead may never die.
And Saido Berahino, who's apparently, I'm assuming, eating fucking bags of Doritos in his house because he just wants to die now.
Oh no, to be honest with you, like where, what I was saying there about pros and cons, like the pro would be switching out Evans for fucking Lescott.
Yeah.
But also the con would be Berahino was totally wasted a season.
That was, from, I could not believe.
Both himself and that team.
Yeah. I could not believe how miserable like they made him. Just fucking sell him off to Spurs if you're gonna be.
But
that
not
much.
Even that. How completely miserable he made himself as well.
Yeah, absolutely.
You know, like any normal person would have gone, right here. Look, let's have a proper conversation. Let's have it out. Let's go for it.
Yeah.
Which apparently, by the way, fucking. Sorry, just a little bit of a segue. Apparently, who was on the bench? Was it? Yannick Bolasie was on the bench for Palace for the FA Cup, wasn't it?
Punchin, yeah.
Apparently him and Pardew had a fucking colossal argument after that because he was on the bench.
Yeah, absolutely, yeah.
He's looking to leave now.
Yeah, that's what they were saying. Apparently, Pardew was trying to say, yeah, it was all part of my plan. Punchin, super sub, perfect. Kiss my face. Oh, shit, we lost. Well. It was fun while it lasted.
True. Anyway, yeah, going back, but with regards to Berahino,
you're wasting him. Like, just don't. Yeah. If you're not going to use him, either release him or sell him off for profit.
He spent the entire season in a sulk.
Yeah.
Yeah.
When you should have sold him off to Spurs when you had the chance. That's the way I saw it.
You did the yaya tour.
Yeah. Wait, is my cake.
Yeah, but the thing is that like it also undermines Pulis's kind of skill as a manager, if he has any, that he couldn't get anything out of him.
No. But again, he does. It looked to me like Pulis didn't want anything to do with him either. Baffles me. Why would you keep him there for the full season? You're just doing that to be a cunt. Like, if Spurs literally said, we'll give you 20 million, right? If you give us this player that you're not going to use all season, you already have a replacement in Salomon Rondon, just give us the player. And you said, no, fuck off then. And then just, again, headbutt him in a shower, presumably. Because that's what West Brom do.
While naked.
While naked, obviously.
With a hat.
With a hat. The story is
how else are you going to fucking do it?
No, man, come on, seriously. PCAP just adds like +2 damage on everything. But, anyway, I think the less said about West Brom, the better for our own.
Because
the mood is already dropping the more we're talking about this club. And Tony
Pulis. They're boring to even talk about, even at a satirical, insulting level.
Yeah, we can't even talk to them. Like, the stats are even just going, eh. Like, the top assist was Chris Brunt, 3.
Oh my god, that's
Rondon, top goal scorer, 9. Highest pass accuracy, this is hilarious, is Joleon Lescott. And he wasn't even in the team for the full fucking season. I love that.
Born the club to the ground.
And we didn't even talk about Darren Fletcher. Right, last club then. West Ham United. 7th place, 62 points. Has to be a good season for West Ham.
Yeah, they were fantastic to watch.
Yeah. I see.
They were a breath of fresh air insofar as a mid-table team as they had become accustomed to being. Like, actually coming out and challenging the top teams, playing great football and testing them and actually beating them on numbers of occasions.
Well, it really it shows you how much kind of Big Sam was holding them back in a way. You know?
He was getting there with them, though, last year.
It's true, yeah. But you saw lads like, at least this season, you saw lads like Mark Noble really step up for West Ham. Like, he took a centre stage for them. And especially with all the other players that were in the squad that still stepped up. Like, you cannot go past Dimitri Payet as a world-class player.
Yeah.
To be honest, absolutely. I don't even think West Ham fans can believe that he's playing for them.
Yeah, it's amazing. And then you had other lads who were trying to catch up with him as well. Like, one lad I will mention here is Michael Antonio, who came in from, Nottingham Forest for pittance in comparison and has slotted in, found a position he's good at, and slotted in, started scoring goals. And
absolutely, that, and yeah. You and mentioned well. You mentioned Noble as well, who's too good for England.
yeah, not good for us apparently, because he won't.
Yeah, care. But like you could name so many people like Creswell, Kouyaté, and of course, yeah, and of course Lanzini.
Yeah, I was about to say Lanzini when he was hot, he was fucking hot, and
hot, obviously he's cool. Shit hot.
Yeah, he was.
But to be honest with you, like Bilic has done really well. He, I mean, like, what is it, top eight?
Yeah, top eight, yeah, in his first season.
Top eight, and Jesus Christ, their FA Cup run was pretty damn good.
Yeah, just a PDA. Away wins. Just ended too soon.
You know, away wins to at Liverpool, yeah. Arsenal, and City.
Was it not Watford that beat you guys in the Cup?
Oh, no, I didn't mean, like, they didn't beat us in the Cup.
Oh, right, yeah, sorry, yeah, 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 sorry.
Yeah, and, but to be honest with you, they have fully, properly moved on after horrendous amounts of years under Big Sam.
Yeah, you can see, like, some of the players did come out of their shell this year. I'd say the one thing, though, the one negative, I would say, was that they've only got target men up front. Maybe it's just me, but I think the West Ham team overall would benefit from having a like counter-attacking player. An example I would use would be Berahino. I think like a Berahino-style player would be suitable for West Ham. Definitely. Just someone that sits on the shoulder and runs.
Sorry, Oxlade Chamberlain could also do that.
Yes, that's true.
Yeah, he could, yeah.
Yeah, absolutely.
I think the only they've no real flops, they've no real bad players. I mean, Valencia didn't kick on, but that's because he was injured all the time.
I would say their loan signings were a bit of a shambles. If you take out Lanzini,
Emenike was
fucking awful. He was awful. I remember Alex Song was there as well, and just like completely forgot about him. You know, like he was actually in the team.
Sacco really struggled as well.
Yeah, he's a big Sam player, I think. You know, just really just muscles people out of the way. I think Carroll will. I think Carroll can do really well with Bilic. I really think so because he's a player that wants the service to him rather than play for it. You know.
Yeah.
So I think definitely, I think Carroll will certainly be a big part player this time, especially because he like scored winning goals this season as well.
Absolutely.
So yeah. Again, another thing that pissed me off about West Ham, and we mentioned this with Southampton, they were very lucky to get Champions or Europa League football this season. They got through the Fair Play Awards. Basically, their whole pre-season was a bit ruined by it, obviously. But when you have the opportunity to go to Europe and to showcase the talents that you have, imagine if Dimitri Payet was given the chance to show off in the Europa League, or Lanzini, or any of the players we mentioned. I said it could have gone pretty far in the Europa League, going by the form they had in the Premier League. Maybe it's just me.
Maybe. I definitely think that any team that goes to Europe should do it.
Yes, especially English clubs because they're so under pressure to perform.
But like, it does take away so much from their league form, and it has to be down to what are the expectations at the start of the season. Is it a case of getting top eight in the season of getting Europe? If it's, you know, if they're aiming for one, the other thing is going to suffer. And that's been the case with so many teams over the years that I think boards of management and the like have to take that into consideration.
Yeah. Well, we did see that with Hull last season, didn't we? Like, they did generally go for Europe and they got stung by it. So, there is a point to be made there, okay, alright. But would you really just kind of abandon it so early? Like, you didn't even give it a chance to flourish. You know, not even the group stages to see who you have. Could have faced some really cool teams. Imagine that. That's your last season at the Berlin ground. I don't know if you noticed or not. Didn't really talk much about it. But last season at the Berlin ground, you could have had teams like Inter Milan or you know, Bilbao or some big team from Germany or Russia or something. Somebody there to send them off. But I guess whatever suits them. They got their league position and now they're in a wonderful starting off point for the new West Ham or Spurs version 2, as I'm calling them. Well, they are. New stadium, new way, new philosophy. We're going to spunk 35 million on Alex, like I said, and get him to say no to us. Hooray! Big club. Okay, well, that's the end of our club-by-club review of the Premiership. So we're going to wrap things up with two quick fire rounds. I am going to ask you guys for your match of the season. Which ones are you going for? Neil, you first.
My match of the season. Jesus. Mm.
There are some humdingers to choose from.
You know, fuck it, yeah. I'm going to go for it. My match of the season to watch was Arsenal's 2-1 win over fucking Leicester.
Ooh, that's it. Now, why are you going for that? Just for how... Just for the fact
you've been Leicester. As an Arsenal fan. Because that gave us hope.
That was such a sad thing to say.
For any Arsenal fan to have.
Exactly. And I will say that. I was about to say that. I was like, and for that reason, I really showed as an Arsenal fan hated. But to be perfectly honest with you, having that genuine hope that we could go on and win it.
That maybe this year is your year. To coin a Liverpool
phrase. And to be honest with you, like, it's... But it was just everything, Emma. Like, it was just... It just showed us that, like, guts...
Yeah.
...is in this team. Like, to just never... We just never gave up and we just dug it in. And we probably didn't do it before or since. But fucking hell, we did it that day.
Just for that fleeting moment. You just saw a little glimmer.
Yeah.
Well, I'll cut in then. I shall give you my match of the year. This shouldn't be a surprise, really. There were some cracking games involving Liverpool this season. I won't name the other two because I think it could be Rachel's. But the one for me has to be in the Europa League quarterfinal. I don't know how the fuck we did this. And it's a shame that we lost ultimately in the final. We let this go to waste. Borussia Dortmund 3, Liverpool 4 on aggregate. 3-2 on the night. I honestly don't know how we did this. It was a 4-3. I can't even remember now. It was 4-3 on the night, sorry. Oh, it was a crazy, crazy night. And I'm just so glad I watched it, like... I didn't watch it live, it wasn't there, but just witnessing it and seeing, is this actually happening to us? Like, we're genuinely beating Borussia Dortmund. The players like Royce and Aubameyang are falling to Sacco and Lovren.
Joe Allen
was the super sub, Rachel. He helped us. He made that match happen. Sorry, getting excited. Rachel, what's your match of the season?
Surprisingly enough, I was the one I attended, Arsenal versus Villa, is obviously the highlight of my life.
Yes.
But
Giroud hat-trick or not.
But in terms of actual end-to-end football, like fantastic attacking, terrible defending. Norwich versus Liverpool, 5-4.
I knew this was coming, because it's just...
Just because, like, what the shit, Liverpool, letting Norwich with their two strikers score, like, four.
It was I know.
Probably more than they scored together all season.
I remember, again, I watched that match as well, because... because it was early, I had nothing else to do for the day, and then I just went, oh, this is going well, we're 2-0 up, this is good. Oh, good, Alberto Moreno happened. Fuck. We're losing, badly. It's 4-4, okay, fine, do you know what, this game is mad, I'm going to leave now. Oh, look, we won, how, what? And I was genuinely like Klopp at the end, just like, not knowing what to do. Like, I just, like, ran around, teeth open, like, what do I do now?
Looking like your lower jaw is trying to escape from your face.
Yeah. Surprisingly enough, I had another match of the season candidate, and we all forgot about it. The trio between ourselves, our teams, Arsenal and Liverpool.
Oh, yeah.
That was a hell of a game, wasn't it?
That was half decent.
Yeah. Do you know why? Because fucking Joe Allen equalised against you. That's fucking why.
Yeah, see, I just forget because he's so nothing.
Yeah, you won't be saying that when he wins the Scottish title for Celtic, you bastards. Right. Moment of the season. Rachel.
Rachel, you
take this first, yes?
The Van Gaal drop.
Yes! Oh. I completely forgot about it. I don't know why, because we watched it live. That was a... Oh, that was...
Where he threw himself down in a mock tantrum, which was a real tantrum.
He took a bump, as we would say.
In front of an entire packed stadium of adults and children, he dropped the floor and then acted as if nothing had happened. And that, like, it was just the most bizarre thing, but totally fitting for Louis van Gaal.
Yeah.
But even though we lost that match and I was super, super pissed off at that, that moment is my moment because, like, what the shit?
A typical Van Hell. That was something, all right. Neil, have you got your moment?
Oh, my. I think I'm going to slightly cheat a bit because... fuck it. I'm going to go for it. My moment was Jose getting sacked.
Ooh, okay. that would be hell of a moment, all right. All right, that's interesting. Would you say, like, I think the match beforehand, though, the fact that he lost to Claudio Ranieri, I think that made it more perfect. And it was just that kind of, like, lasting picture of, like, Ranieri doing the okay, like, gesture, and Mourinho in the background just sulking. That will always be, like, the season. That's a season
that
in a summary.
That could be, like, the cover photo for the season.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. As for me, the moment of the season for me, it's... This season was all about Leicester. I think we all know that. And I think the moment that epitomised everything was Jamie Vardy breaking the goal-scoring record against Manchester United, no less. And just the whole kind of, like... It just felt like it was going to happen. Like, you were following it for, like, 9 or 10 weeks. And just like, yes, he scored again. He's doing it. He's going to happen. And... Just the fact it was, like, just so fitting that it was against United, because it was obviously Van Nistelrooy's record, it was perfect. You couldn't have made it up better. So I would say the moment of the season was Jamie Vardy, 11 games in a row scoring goals. Just chat shit, get banged.
Yeah, that was pretty cool.
Yeah.
That was, like, can't argue with that.
No. Okay, then. Well, how about surprise of the season? Now... We can all admit that Leicester City as a whole were a surprise of the season, but let's just, for pig iron, say something outside of Leicester was a surprise of the season. And I shall go first with this one, because I found this a surprise myself, Brendan Rodgers being sacked so early in the season. More so the nature of the sacking as well, because it was right after the Merseyside derby, when it wasn't an inherently bad game from us. We kind of threw the game away in the end. But the fact it was just like Merseyside derby, he had made a press interview about his future when the journalist very obviously knew he was getting replaced. And just like after the game, right after it, he's gone. And just everyone's just jaw dropped. It was the very infamous Thierry Henry putting the hand on Carragher's lap. And it was like the look of just like...
Oh my God, I forgot about that.
The look of what I would call gay panic on on Carragher's face is like, he's touching my knee. But just that, it was just, that was like, I was not expecting that at all. Because I would have thought, I knew he was kind of on the way out, but not hours after a Merseyside derby. You know, that was a surprise for me. Rachel, what would you...
Well, I'm actually going to go with a managerial sacking that has already been mentioned, and I'm going to say Mourinho, because I thought he might have been invincible.
Wow. you thought he would have lived? Wow. Actually, that's a hell of a what if, actually. What if Mourinho survived this season? Where would they be?
He'd be championship.
They'd be championship. Sadly,
yeah,
true, actually.
Costa,
yeah,
in the championship.
To be fair, the fucking championship is too Costa.
Getting fucked around by actual hard men.
Yeah. Costa would love the championship. He'd be there playing for Ipswich up front with Daryl Murphy. Sorry. Callback humour. Neil, what's your surprise of the season?
Hang on, I had it there for a second. My surprise of the season... My surprise of the season was... Newcastle and Villa getting relegated.
Yes, we were alluding to that earlier. Just end of eras, as you would say.
Yep. To be honest with you, yeah. I mean, Like obviously we said that we couldn't pick Leicester
yes.
winning it at the top. I've gone right for the bottom. And I'm like, okay, then Norwich, all right, then fine. I wouldn't have been too surprised. But Villa and Newcastle, no.
Yeah.
I'd have lost that bet.
Absolutely. Especially considering that Sunderland were like a shoe-in for relegation all throughout the season. And just
Big Sam had upgrades.
Right then. So
he's like that gigantic turd you can't flush down a water pipe.
he's the floater of the Premiership. Alright. Goal of the season this time. Probably have to cast your memories back for a few of them. Has anyone got a goal for the season yet?
I had to double check that this goal was the season because I've replayed it so much in my head.
Yeah,
I just thought it was one of these vintage goals, you know, that, you know, people talk about all the time.
Sure.
But it's Aaron Ramsey's goal versus Spuds.
Now, why have you gone for that one in particular?
Just the flick and the technique used to put it past Lloris was just unreal.
Excellent. Very good.
So I got that one. Also, it made me happy because it was an equaliser.
Yes. And it presumably caused the death of a celebrity. I don't know which one it was, though.
Oh, yeah. Who did that cause? That did actually cause someone's death. But
yeah, it was the one in January.
Lemmy.
You know. What's it?
Was it Lemmy?
I hope
or
not.
Was it Dave Bowie?
If it is the Dave Bowie one, then it's not... It won't be my goal of the season, anyway. I'll double-check that. Neil, what's your goal of the season?
Ha-ha! I'm going petty... As petty can be, my goal of the season was Eden Hazard's equaliser against Spurs.
Now that is petty.
Which sparked off a mini riot. Which led to both teams getting colossal six-figure fines.
Well, at the same token, you do have a point because it was that goal that made Leicester champions. So, you know...
Yeah.
Petty or not, it is a very important goal.
It was a fucking brilliant goal.
Yeah,
as well.
Absolutely. And just so you know, Rachel, that goal that Ramsey scored, the 2-2 draw against Spurs, 5th of March 2016, the next day was Nancy Reagan.
It's
the most recent one. That's fine, yeah. And my goal of the season, completely opposite, is Dele Alli's goal against Crystal Palace. I have seen, that is just, I'm sorry, it was just masterful skill. It was just a chip over the head, volley, straight out. No, I'm sorry, that is the goal of the season. You know, the fact that the player
is actually officially the goal of the season.
Yeah, it has to be. Like, I haven't even checked, to be honest, but that's just the one that stands out to me.
Everybody's been banging on about it, and yeah, it was the only.
Well, in that case, then I'll pick something else. Then I'll pick Jamie Vardy against Liverpool. That was beautiful. I said, "Oh, that is what happens when we chat shit."
Get banged.
Okay, two more quick fire. The fucking hell moment of the season. What was the thing that made you go fucking hell? I shall take this one first. For me, just typically how ruthless the sackings of managers were this season. Like, Advocaat was gone after 8 games, Rodgers was gone after 8, Gary Monk was gone, I think a bit harsh as well. Pellegrini and Van Gaal just dispatched so quickly from the both Manchester clubs. Just generally, managers were treated like fucking shit this season.
Yeah.
They really were. And it's unfair on them because it's ultimately down to players for their performance. And even Pellegrini and Van Gaal, there's just mitigating circumstances to that as well. It's not even down to performance. It's the fact that, ooh, big celebrity is on the market. Let's snag him before anyone else does. It's just, there's so much disillusion about the whole thing. And that's what makes me sad. So that's my fucking hell moments of the season.
They're fairly shocking.
Yeah.
My one, I'm going to go with... Sacco and his drugs failure.
That is a very good moment, to be fair.
Interesting.
Not for Liverpool, obviously, because we actually fucking needed him. But
he was actually doing so well.
Just fucked it all up.
Yeah.
But it was kind of funny as well. You could actually see how the form improved when he took the fat burners at Old Trafford. It was just kind of that game where it all started. He started to get better. So yeah, I agree with you. That's a pretty damn moment for him. And so Neil, what's yours then?
My fucking hell moment was Arsenal losing 3-2 to a fucking, quite possibly the direst, most awful, god-awful shithead, shitbird fucking Manchester United team I have ever seen.
The Let's Watch, shit-head. Yes. You made Marcus Rashford a star. That's what you did. That's Arsenal's legacy. You gave the man a career.
Unbefucking-leavable.
Can't even do his GCSEs.
We lay down and died like fucking dogs. And it was fucking atrocious. Especially when you consider that earlier that season, with a much better Manchester United team, we absolutely cut them to fucking rhythm.
Yeah. That's typical Arsenal.
Yeah.
Okay, last award then, if you can call it these, is the Omni-Shambles of the season. Or failure of the season, whichever one you prefer. Anyone got the same team for this one? I don't know. We'll see. There have been a few good examples of it. Rachel, what's your Omni Shambles of the season?
I have a joint Omni Shambles.
Ooh. very fancy.
One part being Rory Neal, just in general, just failing at life.
Oh, right. Yeah.
Yep.
And Spuds failing to get second place.
So you're really not bitter about this at all, are you? You're really taking this on board that Spurs nearly got you.
Yeah, but they didn't, and it made it the best birthday ever.
And I'll get you next season then. I'm gonna go slightly on same wavelength as you, Rach. I'm gonna just say generally Chelsea were the only shambles. Just the players, the manager, all the bullshit going around. Signing players like Falcao and Pato. Like, when you're signing a player named after a fucking duck, that's the level your club is at, and you should feel bad as a result. You signed a player called Pedro just to say fuck you to the United. That's not how you do football. That's just being a cunt. And that's why we call Chelsea cunts.
Cunts.
Cunts. Neil, you're on the shambles of the season.
Newcastle.
Ooh, interesting. Interesting indeed.
I said this personally because I actually quite like Newcastle.
Mm.
And I think what makes it... See, the thing is that it was very obvious, like, quite a bit of the way into the season that, like, Villa had no hope.
Yeah.
They had no chance. They were never staying up. I mean, like, they'd been gone for months. But, like, Newcastle, as we said before, like, Benitez was... the right thing to Benitez was the man for the job, and they just did not sign him. They never put him in. They stuck with McLaren. And so the thing is that, like, Villa never had a chance. They could have appointed fucking the Pope, you know, and they wouldn't have done it. However, all Newcastle had to do was just get rid of a man who was so obviously poor for the job rather than giving him an 8-year contract.
Fucking,
you know, like, so that's a case of you have the right answer and you've deliberately chosen to, like, fire into the wrong answer.
intentionally go for the wrong answer, that's
my point. Like, that's what's a horrible failure. Like, Villa were going down no matter, the only way Villa could, short of a nuclear apocalypse, Villa were going down.
Yeah, definitely.
But all Newcastle had to do was the right thing, and they still couldn't do it. And now they're going down.
Yep. They only have themselves to blame.
And that's the thing, like, they really only have themselves to blame. Yeah.
There you go. Okay. Well, that's our moment of the season. And before we wrap up then, it's going to be the quickest fires of quick fire rounds that we're calling the Crystal Football, where I am going to ask these two gentlemen and myself to predict the future of these 29 footballers. We will review this when we eventually do our Transfer Deadline Day special and see how many of them turned out to be correct. So starting off strong, Jamie Vardy. I am going for Manchester United.
Liverpool City.
Ooh, interesting spread there. obviously we know it's not going to happen, so it's fair enough. Riyad Mahrez. I am going to go for Atletico Madrid.
Manchester United.
Real.
Ooh, okay. Interesting choices there. N'Golo Kante. Neil, what will you go for?
Arsenal.
Rachel?
Ooh. PSG.
I am also going to go for Arsenal. Yes. Do you know why? Because he's your fucking Vieira that you've missed for years. Let's go for next then. For Spurs player, let's go for Harry Kane. Neil, where will Harry Kane go to?
I'd probably follow his other mongoloid fucking teammate to Real.
Oh, okay. I'm going for the same one here, Real Madrid.
Yes,
I am. Right, so all three for Real. We've all put our eggs in that basket. Hugo Lloris. That's an interesting one. True. In I was going to say he'll go to Juventus.
I say Paris Saint Germain.
Okay.
Yeah, I was going to say Paris Saint Germain.
All right, interesting. Now some Arsenal players. Jack Wilshere. Where will Jack go next?
City.
Rachel, City. Neil.
Barca.
Barcelona, really?
Yeah, they always poach our good ones.
Fair enough. Okay, and I am also going for Manchester City. So two votes for City there. Theo Walcott. What's his next club, Neil?
The skip out my back garden.
That's not a club. No matter how much you can try and get that license for it.
Give it a crest if you want me to.
It's not the crest. It's more the lack of facilities, lack of players, your inability to pay wages. It's a lot of legislation you're missing there, mate.
West Ham.
Ooh, okay, West Ham.
I was going to say the same.
Well, I was going to say Liverpool, because he is a right winger and we don't have one.
We have Werner.
Okay, how about Memphis Depay? The poor bastard. Where is he going to end up? I'm saying Roma, because he's been linked with an Italian club the last few weeks.
Bournemouth.
Sorry, I don't know what to make me so funny. It's just Bournemouth. God, I can imagine it. Just him in the red and black, just waiting for death.
Yeah.
Neil, pray tell, where do you think he's going?
Well, I was gonna say Roma as well because of the linkage.
Yeah. Okay, Roma as well then. David De Gea. So, was meant to go to Real Madrid, but didn't. Where would he go this season if he had to? Rachel.
Real.
All right. Okay. Two votes for Real.
He's not going anywhere else.
I'm going to go contra to you guys and say Juve. I generally think Juve will try and find a keeper to replace Buffon. Because Juventus will be silly and do that. Because of course they will. Football is crazy. Now, here's a blue chipper. Shane Long. Where will Shane Long go, Rachel? If he had to move somewhere, what club would it be?
Like, the only club I can kind of see him being needed. Like, as an out-and-out striker for them. West Brom.
Ooh, so you have to go back to West Brom then.
Yeah.
Interesting. Neil?
Arsenal.
Ooh. Okay. Have you got a reason for that or just general fan service?
No. Honestly, I think he'd do really, really well. I think his extreme energy levels and an eye for the ball, I just think he'd kick on really well.
Yeah.
And given the sheer amount of service we could provide for him, I think he'd have a blast.
Just at the top front two of Giroud and Long.
Sploosh.
Sploosh.
Well, funny enough, Neil, that's for those reasons that you described, able to get loads of service, more or less playing the shoulder of the last man, bundles of pace, bundles of energy, is why I went for Liverpool, because I see Long as one of the ideal Klopp forwards. And I genuinely mean that. I'm not being like, you know, patriotic or anything. I genuinely think that's the kind of placeholder he's looking for as a striker. Okay, how about his Southampton teammate, Sadio Mane? I am saying Manchester United, because they already bid and failed for him, but they will try again.
Chelsea.
Ooh.
I was actually going to say Chelsea as well.
All right. That's a very interesting thing to see. Dimitri Payet.
That nasty streak.
Huh?
Yeah.
He's got that real nasty streak.
And yeah, I guess so. You could be right. Might be onto something. What about Dimitri Payet? Where would he go next? Neil?
Yeah. Dortmund.
Dortmund, really? Interesting. I'm going to say PSG.
I'd say Atletico.
Ooh, I'd like to see that, actually. I think he'd do really well there. Okay, all right. Let's move on then to Daniel Sturridge. A few Liverpool players on this list. Where will Sturridge play next? I am going to say Arsenal. I guarantee, believe me, this is, Arsenal would go for him. I guarantee it. What would you?
I actually reckon Manchester United.
Ooh, Jesus, imagine that. That would ruffle some feathers.
He'd cross the divide. He'd cross the red divide.
Wow, that would ruffle some feathers.
Everton.
Oh, you're a fucking mercenary. I swear to God. Oh, all right. Okay. All right. His strike partner then, Christian Benteke. We've already spoken about this, but I've said West Ham straight out.
Yeah, West Ham.
Yeah.
FC Glue Factory.
Also known as West Ham.
Yeah. Pretty much West Ham. Yeah.
Eden Hazard. I would say PSG. Pretty straightforward answer.
Yeah. I can't see anybody past Paris Saint-Germain.
Yeah. Seems perfect.
I look at him and I see that god awful jersey on him.
Yeah, it suits him in a way, doesn't it? Just
yeah, it really does.
Low intensity, miserable league, all bound, destined to win. He'd be happy.
Huge amount of cash.
Yep. And would you agree, Rachel?
I was going to say Dortmund again.
Some interesting choices there for Dortmund.
That would be interesting.
Yeah. And how about this then for our Evertonians? Romelu Lukaku. Where will he go next?
Arsenal.
Really?
Yeah.
I'm genuinely surprised by that, because I was going to say Dortmund. I think it's nailed on that he'll go to Dortmund. That's just the way I'm thinking. It's just going to happen. They don't spend that much money though, but fuck it. They might do it for him. Okay, Gylfi Sigurdsson. Thought I'd throw this one in just to see. I'm going to say Liverpool, because we actually do need a set piece specialist to replace James Milner. Really need one. Really need one.
I'd actually go with Liverpool as well.
Yeah.
Everton.
Okay, no, I can see that actually. I can see that happening. If they get a good manager in, I can see him moving. That's.
Yeah.
Alright, yeah, okay. How about Saido Berahino? Where would
Spurs.
He. Spurs, yeah.
Yeah, Spurs.
All right. I went for something very interesting. I went for Leicester City. And the reason I say that is because
really?
I would leave, yeah. Because he is pacey. He is prolific, much like Vardy is. And I would say Ranieri would be quite the father figure to Berahino, which is probably what he needs. Just a thought. Anywho, I have a few Newcastle players on it, so we'll go through these fairly quickly. Tim Krul, I'm saying AC Milan. What would you say? What would you say, guys?
Everton. Howard's gone at the end of... Well, he's gone now, so...
That's a good point, actually. Yeah, Everton could go for him. He'd be on the cheap as well,
because
he'd be Newcastle.
I'd say Everton.
Good.
As well.
Good move, lads, yeah. Okay, Andros Townsend.
Shit, who did I say earlier on?
Southampton, yeah.
Southampton.
You guys saying Southampton? Well, I am going to say, what was it? What did I have down? I had Everton down. Sorry, I had Everton down for Townsend. So for some reason, we're all convinced that like somebody from Newcastle is going to go to Everton, because I have, because right next to him is Georgina Wijnaldum, who I also have down as Everton. I'm convinced someone from Newcastle is going to Everton.
Yeah, I'd go to Everton for Wijnaldum as well.
Yeah. Everyone okay with Everton?
I said Swansea.
Ooh, Swansea, ooh. Oh yeah, you said that.
Yeah.
Hey, that'd be a good move for him, actually. And speaking of a former Swan, John Joe Shelvey.
Where Transylvania FC.
He's gonna go to Romania. All right, okay, that makes sense. What would you?
Galatasaray.
Whoa, he's gonna go way out then. So you're going Romania, Turkey. I'm gonna go for somewhere even grimmer than that. West Brom. And I say that because youth. Pulis did say he wanted young players, and West Brom would be the perfect place for him. Okay, Antoine Griezmann. I am saying Chelsea straight out, because obviously Chelsea and Letico are our best mates.
Yeah, I'd say Chelsea had stuck out for.
Yeah. All right, so we're all going for Chelsea. Karim Benzema. Now, we had spoken about this earlier in the night.
Manu.
It seems pinned on, but I was going to say a Chinese club. Just no, any of the names. I know. Well, oh yeah, because tweets are totally like on board and on par and everything. Here's one here for you. Javi Martinez, central defender for Bayern Munich. I am saying he will be Guardiola's first signing at Manchester City. In free to Gundogan, obviously, because that seems pretty much nailed on.
Yeah, I agree.
Manchester United.
Ooh, all right. Ooh. Interesting. How about this one? Henrik Mkhitaryan. Fuck it up. Mkhitaryan. The Armenian chap from Borussia Dortmund. The assist king of Europe. City, really?
City. Yep.
See, right?
Chelsea.
I'm going to say Bayern Munich. Because they fucking buy everybody. It's like, oh, you're one of our nearest rivals. Bought, signed.
They've already taken Hummels.
This is true. And they might go back again. Speaking of which, Pierre-Emerick Aubameyang. I am saying Real Madrid.
Arsenal.
Oh, imagine. Jeez, if you got Aubameyang, you'd be fucking unstoppable.
Yeah, but he's never going to leave Dortmund.
I would agree with that, Or if he is, going to be four triple digits.
I reckon the only team that could buy him out of his contract right now would be City.
All right. That would be a hell of a partnership up front. Aguero and Aubameyang. The AA. That doesn't work, sorry. Marco Reus, his partner in crime, his Robin to his Batman. Where will he go?
Bayern.
Well, Chelsea as well. I was going to say Bayern Munich as well. Because again, they'll buy German just to look nice. Another one from the Bundesliga. Thought I'd throw this fellow in. Javier Hernandez for Bayer Leverkusen. Chicharito, as he's commonly known.
Liverpool.
Oh, you're saying Liverpool, Neil. Okay, that's interesting.
Yeah.
I can see it happening. Possibly. I am going to say Arsenal. You see, it's again being prolific, and he's been prolific this season. Plays on the shoulder, like Arsenal likes.
True.
And have you got one?
Oh, it's West Brom.
Oh, good God! The sight of it. I can't unsee that now. It's awful. Right, what have we got next then? Is Zlatan Ibrahimovic. I am saying Manchester United. I think they will actually spend as much money as they possibly can to get him in, and he'll be useless.
I'm going Manchester United as well, yeah.
Yep.
I think we're all pretty convinced on that. And right beside him, Edison Cavani. Again, I'm convinced that United will do as much as they can to sign either one of those two.
I think Cavani might be a Chelsea thing.
Maybe. Possible Diego Costa replacement?
Maybe.
Yeah, I was going to say Chelsea too.
Interesting. Okay, we're nearing the end of this now. Alexander Lacazette. He had a bid from West Ham rejected, but I am going to say he will be a Spurs player at the end of the transfer window.
Liverpool.
Oh, I'd love it. Oh, God, it'd be amazing. Not going to happen, though, because we're terrible at transfers.
Yeah, I'd go with Liverpool as well.
Oh, you're literally too kind. I'll take it though, fuck it. Michy Batshuayi scored 20 plus goals for Marseille. I would say more likely than this to happen than Lacazette, but he's going to go for Spurs. What about you guys?
Ooh.
I might not know too much about this player, but he has been linked with a lot of Premier League clubs. It's almost like it's guaranteed he's moving to England, but he doesn't know which club yet. That's what the reports in France are saying.
Southampton.
Ooh, that'd be a cool move.
Neil? Partner Long.
Partner Long, yeah. A match made in heaven.
No, Giroud
and Longley. Yeah, I suppose. What about you, Neil? Are you there?
I reckon Manchester United.
Hmm. Alright, maybe. Alright, okay. Last few now. Alvaro Morata. I think this one is fairly obvious. Arsenal. Because they are hunting him, so if it's going to happen, it'll be Arsenal. And similarly, Pablo Dybala, another Arsenal target, so hence I'm saying Arsenal.
I reckon he'll go to somebody like Juve or something like that.
He's already at Juve, don't you know?
Oh, shit, sorry. Yeah, that's fucking...
Wolfsburg.
What do you think, Neil?
Trying to think. I reckon he'll go to one of the Milan clubs.
That'd be an interesting switch, wouldn't it? Okay,
yeah.
Alright. Let's move on then. Last few. Paul Pogba. I think this one is fairly pinned on Barcelona.
Yeah.
They're totally going to go for him. That's their number one target this season. We think we're all agreed on that one?
Yes.
Barca, yeah. Okay. Miralem Pjanic from AS Roma. I am saying he will be a Chelsea player at the end of the summer.
West Ham.
Ooh, wow, that would be a fucking great signing.
Yeah.
That would be a statement of intent if you got him. Him and Payet running the field. Wow.
That's a I'd go with Chelsea on him.
Yeah, okay. Last one then. Gonzalo Higuain. I am going to go very contra and say Barcelona.
Oh.
Imagine that, former Real man, and then goes to Barca. What about you guys?
City.
Ooh, wow, that'd be a sweet partnership as well. All right, last one then. The last, but most certainly not least, Colo Torre. The correct answer is, of course, in all of our hearts. That's where he's going next.
All is well.
There is no need to be upset. Well, that was it then. That's Crystal Football, and that is the very much elongated pilot of the football podcast. So, how was that for you guys? Did you enjoy that?
That was pretty good.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's not as if I didn't need that sleep anyway, so yeah. Like I said, for those of you listening...
I'm staying with much Thrones now, I may as well.
Might as well, yes, indeed. Right, well, thank you, Neil and Rachel, for joining us on this wonderful journey into the football realm. And we will hopefully be back for another episode of the podcast when we will be previewing the Euro 2016 Championships in live from France. And hopefully you can join us for that soon, and we'll see you when we see you. Toodles.
Bye.